Thank you. gonna wrap my arms around my daddy's neck and tell him that I've missed him. And tell him all about the man that I became and hope that it pleased him. So much I wanna say, so much I want you to know. When I finally make it home, when I gaze upon the throne of the King, frozen in my steps. And all the questions that I swore I would ask, words just won't come yet. I'm so amazed in what I've seen, so much more than this old mind. When I finally make it home, when I voices of the angels. When I find I'm
God bless you. You may be seated.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God. Born of His Spirit, washed in His blood. This is my story. This is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I am my Savior, am happy and blessed, watching and waiting, looking above, filled with His Spirit, washed in His blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long.
Family and friends, we are gathered here this afternoon to remember and to celebrate the life of Johnny Merriman. Johnny Paul Merriman of Emory, Texas, passed away on September the 2nd, 2020, at the age of 77. He was born on August the 31st, 1943, to George Russell and Betty Jo Williams Merriman in McKinney. Johnny married Linda Jean Carter Barron on March the 28th, 1999 in Plano. Today, Johnny is survived by his wife, Linda Merriman of Emory, his son, Kelly Merriman, and wife, Julie of Meridian, his brother, Jimmy Merriman, and wife, Raynell of Plano, two grandsons, Cliff Merriman and wife, Anna of Malta, Montana, Blake Merriman of Houston, Texas, niece, Erica Merriman Moss and husband Scott of Irving, stepchildren Wendy Barron Gracie and husband Tom of Weston, Texas, Matt Barron and wife Robin of Fort Worth, Tim Barron and wife Misty of Tyler, three step-grandchildren, five great-grandchildren, and numerous other living family members and friends. Johnny was preceded in death by his parents, G.R. and Betty Merriman. Johnny graduated from Plano High School in 1961. He attended the University of North Texas. He later joined and served as a veteran in the United States Air Force, working on B-52 bombers and KC-135 during the Vietnam War. And we are grateful and thankful for Johnny's service to his country. Johnny farmed and ranched in the Plano area for many years and later moved to Emory, where he also ranched. He was an avid sportsman, enjoying horsemanship, car racing, hunting, and fishing. Johnny was also a deputy constable for both Dallas and Collin counties. Let me share with you as we celebrate and remember Johnny's life this afternoon, and I pray that the Word of God will be a comfort to you, family and friends, as I read Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in paths of righteousness for His name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, For thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And again, may the Lord use his word today to comfort us, family and friends, as we think fondly of Johnny and his time with us here on earth.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not, thy compassions they fail not. As thou hast been, great is thy faithfulness, morning by morning new mercies I see. All I have need and thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto sin, and a peace that endureth. Thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide. Strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings all mine, thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness, morning by morning new mercies I see. All I have needed thy hand hath provided. Great is thy
time. Johnny's brother Jimmy Merriman, to be followed by a friend Jim Chapman, are going to come and eulogize Johnny.
Johnny was my one and only brother. Gosh, I've known him for 71 years. Johnny being 5 years older, you can imagine who won all the battles that we had between each other. Johnny had a very good grip that he developed from the dairy milking of the daily milking of our Jersey milk cow. He would often squirt milk at me and our dogs and cat. Johnny got his love of fishing from our granddad, Pawpaw Merriman. Although Johnny did not have a driver's license, Pawpaw would have Johnny drive his pickup to the area lake so they could fish. Johnny loved to go deer hunting. He had many nice whitetail and mule deer and elk that he harvested in Texas and New Mexico. Johnny loved to set up race cars, and he worked on his cars in the shop that we had on the farm. Many times after Dad had already gone to bed, Dad would yell various quotes to Johnny to shut the engine off. Johnny would test his cars on the White Rock Road that led to our house. It was a single lane road that was very bumpy. I would ride with him and hold on, hoping that we would not wreck out. Occasionally, Johnny would test his car on Parker Road. I can recall Dad and I coming home from Plano, and Dad would see all the black tire marks on the pavement. And Dad would say, "Looks like your brother is testing his car again." Johnny and I went to many drag strips together. He had three different race cars, all 1955 Chevrolets. The last car that he had was named Chinese Bandit. It was red and very fast. He won the AHRA Nationals in 1963 at Green Valley Raceway in Smithfield, Texas. Johnny was a great mechanic. He was always repairing my broken cars, Dad's trucks, tractors, and combines. Some of the crazy things we did together: we had a chicken house, and I was sent to gather the eggs in the dark. I reached into a nest and grabbed a chicken snake. I ran back to the house and told Johnny. He went back down to the chicken house with me. I pointed out the nest, and he blew a hole in the wall with the 12-gauge shotgun. In his pickup, we chased a coyote across the wheat fields between Rowlett Creek and Cottonwood Creek. He was driving, and I was shooting at the coyote with a pistol. I never hit the coyote, but we wore him out as he fled across Cottonwood Creek. We both had a very large laugh about it. Anyway, I love Johnny. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Jim Chapman. For 38 years, Johnny Merriman was my best friend. It wasn't the, "Hey, we're friends now," but it grew and developed. I first met Johnny at the gun show in Market Hall. He said, "Hey, I heard you like to go elk hunting." I said, "I sure do. Well, let's go sometime." So he said, "I also got a garden out here. Why don't you and your family come out and pick a few tomatoes and whether you went out the garden?" My wife went out there and she said, "Oh my gosh, you got to see this garden." I said, "It must be 4 or 5 acres. So Cindy said, you need to be nice to this guy. So both of us played high school football. I went on to play in college. And Johnny and I really liked football games, especially high school football games. And both of my boys played football at Lake Highlands. And Johnny and Linda would come and cheer them on. And even one time when we were coming back from Colorado, we stopped for fuel in Iowa Bar. And he said, what's all the big commotion about today? He said, oh, this is a big game. It's Quanah and Iowa Park. Johnny looked at me and said, hey, we got two horses out here. Let's take them and take them out here to the football stadium. We'll let them out, then get some exercise, and we'll go watch a football game. So we watched a high school football game. The people around there said, or do you have kids playing? No, we don't have kids playing. We're both from Dallas and Plano. Well, next thing we knew, we were up in the announcer stand, and they were interviewing us. Why don't you come out here? Well, we just like a good football game. And that's what we did. We did a good football game. And I moved my office about, right on Leonard Road, and Johnny was up here in Plano, and he had called me the other day. He said, let's go eat lunch. I said, well, where do you want to go eat? We've got to be like two old women. I don't know where we want to go eat. Why don't you tell me where to go eat? No, I don't want to go eat there. No, I had that last night. No, let's go there. And we'd pretty soon wind up to Richards, Little Richards up there. And that's where we'd eat. And first time we went dove hunting down at the ranch with Johnny, he had a 410 shotgun. I had a 12 gauge. And he sent me down here about 50 yards away. He got up there on the other end. And every time a dove would come by, he'd go, pop. And then we'd come out. I was like, I'm going to get that one as soon as he gets closer. And before he'd get there, pop. Johnny would shoot it. So pretty soon he came by and he said, I got my limit. How many do you have? None. He said, well, you brought four boxes of shells. I said, yeah, I did. He said, well, take these because I still got 15 left. Okay. So that was the type of Johnny was. I think the most impressive thing was that we'd go to Colorado, and our big deal was to get up early in the morning before daylight. We'd sell up our horses, we'd go almost to the top of the mountain, and we'd get near to the top, and then we'd get off, we'd tie the horses up, and then walk over the crest, and we'd sit there, and we'd watch the sun come up. And Johnny said, you know, how could anybody not believe that something higher up made all this? It just didn't happen. And that was Johnny Merriman. He also liked to play a few cards with Larry and Mike. And he'd always tell how much he won, how bad he beat him. He said, Larry just got all set up. And he said, I'm just going to go back to Arkansas. You guys are killing me. So I guess Johnny was pretty good at cards. And we'd read our daily scripture. Johnny would take and read his on a little booklet. I'd read mine on the cell phone. And we'd tell each other about it. And he also had his kind of names to everybody. And we kind of talk in code. I mean, there was Captain Salty, and there was Budget, and there was Wendy. And there was Blacksmith and Beakball and Dumpling. And we could tell about the different things that we saw and went on. But the thing I remember most about Johnny was that anytime he'd call me, he'd say, oh yeah, what's going on, Big Dog? Now, I don't know who Big Dog was. He didn't know who Big Dog was. And I'd answer him back, oh yeah, Big Dog, is that you? So we had a good time doing that. He was my best friend. And if there's anything I could say right now, it'd be, hey, Big Dog, what's going on up there? And he'd answer me. So thank you.
Thank you, Jimmy. Thank you, Jim. I want to share one verse of scripture with you this afternoon in our few minutes that we have remaining. It's from Romans chapter 5 and verse 1. And if you have a smart device and you'd like to find that, please feel free to do so. Romans chapter 5, verse 1. Here's what Paul said to the Roman church. Therefore, having been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Let me read that again. Romans chapter 5, verse 1. Therefore, having been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. I want you to think about for just a moment. If Johnny could stand before us this afternoon and say one last thing, what would it be? We are prone to remember, think about, dwell on the last words of individuals. What would Johnny say to us if he could speak to us this afternoon? Would he say, hey, let's go to a football game? Would he say, anybody want to go fishing? One of my fondest memories with Johnny is, I believe it was last October, Johnny paid for us a guide on Lake Fork out in Raines County, and we had caught our limit of catfish in about 50 minutes. Awesome, awesome morning. In today's world, you might think, if you know Johnny well, you might think he would say, be sure to vote for Trump. But I can promise you this. If Johnny could stand before us one last time and say anything, he wouldn't say, let's go to a football game. He wouldn't say, does anybody want to go fishing? He wouldn't say anything about our upcoming presidential election. He would say this, put your faith and trust in Christ. That's what he would say. I'm absolutely 100% confident that Johnny, knowing what he knows now better than he has ever known it in his life, he would say, put your faith and trust in Christ. Or, again, as the Apostle Paul said, be at peace with God through your faith in Jesus Christ. When Paul said here in this passage of Scripture that he was justified, that we are justified, to be justified means to be made right, to be declared right. And what is assumed there is that we have a need to be made right. And the truth of the matter is that we all are in need of justification because we are all sinners and we fall short of the glory of God. And it's our sin that separates us from a holy God. But the good news of the gospel is that God loved the world so much that he gave his only begotten son, so that anyone who would believe in him would have everlasting life. You see, even though we're sinners, and I certainly include myself, even though I'm a sinner, I make bad choices, I make mistakes, Jesus Christ lived a sinless, perfect life. And when an individual, any individual, puts his or her faith in Christ and trusts him as Lord and Savior, he or she is justified or made right. Not because of what you did, not because of what I did, not because of what Johnny did, but because of what Jesus did on our behalf. You see, we live in a world today that says you can be made right by your morality. If you just live a good enough life, and at the end of your days, as long as your good outweighs your bad, you'll get through. No, sir. No, ma'am. You're not made right by morality. You're not made right by baptism. You're not made right by church membership. You're not made right by your family tree. You can only be made right by your faith in Jesus Christ. And when a person is justified or made right because of your faith, you then and only then have peace with God through Jesus Christ. We hear people talk about that today. Are you at peace with a man upstairs? Have you made your peace with the Creator? All of that is a reference to be made right by faith in Christ and being at peace with God. Jesus said his own words, "The only way that a person can be made right is through me." He said, "I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life." And then in a very unpopular, not politically correct way, he said, "No one comes to the Father except through me." John 14:6. If Johnny were here this afternoon, I know he might want to talk about football. He loved football, loved high school football. He loved to hunt, loved to fish, loved his family, loved his friends, even loved to talk politics. But I can assure you this, if he could say one last thing, he would say, "Put your faith in Christ. That's the only way that you'll be at peace with God." Let's pray together. Father in heaven, we're grateful for Johnny. We're grateful for his friendship. We're grateful for his wife, his children, his grandchildren, his brother, his friends, his extended family. We're grateful for the fond memories that we can think about and celebrate on a day like today. And Lord, I pray that you would keep those in our mind throughout this day. We're grateful and thankful for the fun that we've had with Johnny. But more than anything else, Lord, we're grateful for what you did on Johnny's behalf. You saved him. You saved him when he put his faith and trust in your son, Jesus. And Father, now he is at peace with you because he had received Christ as Savior and Lord of his life. Father, we're comforted by the truth that those who put their faith and trust in Christ have a home in heaven. We believe that's where Johnny is this afternoon. Your word says to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. And we thank you for that. Lord, my hope and my prayer is that if there's anyone within the sound of my voice this afternoon, family or friend, that if they have never put their faith and trust in Christ, if right now they are not at peace with God, they're not at peace with their Creator, that they would call on the name of the Lord to save them. They would receive Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior of their life. That's what Johnny did. And because of that truth, we know Johnny has been made right and is at peace with God and has a home in heaven. Lord, we love you. We thank you for loving us first. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. The family has asked that we sing a hymn of praise together, so I'd invite you to stand at this time. The words will appear on the screens behind me. We sing to the God that Johnny put his faith in how great thou art. O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think that God his Son not sparing sent him to die, I scarce can take it in that on the cross my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Amen. I'd ask if those who are attending, who are not family, if you would go ahead and take a seat. I believe that the funeral home is going to come in, and I'm going to, at this time, dismiss the family. Dismiss the family. I believe you are going to go ahead and go out the back. Is that correct? Come on in. Casket. Thank you. friends, after the family departs, if you would stay in your seats, our task team will come around and will take you out row by row. I'd encourage you, those that are going on to Restland, there will be a police escort, and so if you could proceed to your vehicles and then wait for that caravan to begin. And the funeral home just asks that you be careful and pay very special attention during that time. We're so grateful that you're here to honor Johnny's life today. Be blessed and just stay in place until someone comes to get you.